Before we get started, just one quick announcement, and that is that there's a sign-up sheet on the back table for anybody who wants to come tomorrow and help supervise so that I don't have to be here for all 12 hours. With that, we begin tonight's Tenebrae service. Tenebrae is Latin for shadows or darkness. It is the name given to an ancient order of worship meant to remind Christians of the terrible consequences of their sins. It also draws us closer to Christ as we recognize the depth of his love for us, as demonstrated by his life-giving sacrifice on the cross. The distinctive feature of the Tenebrae service is the gradual extinguishing of all the lights in the church. The darkened church reminds us of the darkness which covered the earth when Jesus hung on the cross. By the end of the service, only the Christ candle will remain lit, and even that will be removed for a time and from the chancel and hidden, just as Jesus' body was removed from the cross and hidden in the tomb for 3 days. At the end of the service, the congregation will leave the church in silent, somber meditation. This is the second day of the Triduum, the 3 days of somber meditations on our Lord's Passion. Tomorrow, the church will be open from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. for those who wish to come and spend time here in quiet meditation and prayer. We begin now by singing our opening hymn, O Sacred Head, Now Wounded, hymn 449.
Thank you.
rise for prayer. God the Father in heaven. God the Son, Redeemer of the world.
Have mercy.
God the Holy Spirit.
Have mercy.
Be gracious to us.
Spare us, good Lord.
Be gracious to us.
Help us, good Lord.
By the mystery of your holy incarnation, your holy nativity, your baptism, by your fasting and temptation, by your agony and bloody sweat, by your cross and passion, and by your precious death and burial,
help us, good Lord.
In all times of tribulation, in all times of our prosperity, in the hour of death, and in the day of judgment,
help us, good Lord.
We poor sinners implore you to hear us, O Lord, to prosper the preaching of your word, to bless our prayer and meditation, to strengthen and preserve us in the true faith, to give heart to our sorrow and strength to our repentance.
We implore you to hear us, good Lord.
To draw all men to yourself, to bless those who are instructed in the faith, to watch over and console the poor, the sick, the distressed, the lonely, the forsaken, the abandoned, and all who stand in need of our prayers.
We implore you to hear us, good Lord.
Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world,
have mercy.
Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world,
have mercy.
Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world,
grant us your peace.
O Christ,
hear us.
O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
On this day of darkness and shadows, we are confronted with the full magnitude of our sins. We cannot look upon our crucified Lord and still think of them lightly. Although the cross is the sign of God's forgiveness, we know that his grace came at a terrible price, the sacrificial death of his sinless Son. Therefore, let us consider the role that our sins played in the suffering and death of Jesus. Forgive us, Lord, for all the sins we have knowingly and unknowingly committed. We have sinned against you with our thoughts, our words, and our deeds. The sin we inherited from our first parents continues to be a stumbling block to us. Yet, to redeem and restore us, you were willing to endure the cross and grave. Therefore, our hope is only and always in you. Forgive us, O Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, graciously behold this, your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and delivered into the hands of sinful men. For our sake he suffered death on the cross to pay for our sins and redeem us from your wrath. Have mercy on us for his sake, who with you and the Holy Spirit is one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please remain standing as our offerings are brought forward. For our offertory hymn, we sing four verses of O Perfect Life of Love, hymn 452.
Thank you.
Please be seated. We now continue by speaking the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our service continues now with a responsive reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapters 52 and 53. Behold, my servant shall act wisely.
He shall be high and lifted up, and shall be exalted.
For he grew up before him like a young plant,
and like a root out of the dry ground.
He had no form or majesty that we should look at him,
and no beauty that we should desire him.
He was despised and rejected by men,
a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief,
as one from whom men hide their faces.
He was despised, and we esteemed him not.
Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows,
yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted.
But he was pierced for our transgressions.
He was crushed for our iniquities.
Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace,
and with his wounds we are healed.
All we like sheep have gone astray.
We have turned every one to his own way.
And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
He was oppressed, and he was afflicted,
yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter,
and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth.
And they made his grave with the wicked,
and with a rich man in his death,
although he had done no violence,
and there was no deceit in his mouth.
Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him.
He has put him to grief.
By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant,
make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities.
We now sing hymn 451, Stricken, Smitten, and Afflicted.
Thank you.
Our reading now from the New Testament, the book of Hebrews, chapters 4 and 5. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A responsive reading now from Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me?
Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning?
O my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer.
And by night, but I find no rest.
But I am a worm and not a man,
scorned by mankind and despised by the people.
All who see me mock me.
They make mouths at me. They wag their heads.
He trusts in the Lord. Let him deliver him.
Let him rescue him,
for he delights in him. Be not far from me, for trouble is near,
and there is none to help.
Many bulls encompass me.
Strong bulls of Bashan surround me.
They open wide their mouths at me,
like a ravening and roaring lion.
I am poured out like water,
and all my bones are out of joint.
My heart is like wax, it is melted within my breast.
My strength is dried up like a potsherd,
and my tongue sticks to my jaws.
You lay me in the dust of death.
For dogs encompass me, a company of evildoers encircles me.
They have pierced my hands and feet.
I can count all my bones.
They stare and gloat over me.
They divide my garments among them,
and for my clothing they cast lots.
The first reading for tonight comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23. Two others who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him. And the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by, watching. But the rulers scoffed at him, saying, He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one. The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine, and saying, If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. There was also an inscription over him, This is the king of the Jews. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. If Jesus ever uttered anything less believable, I don't know what it is. What's hard to believe is not that he would pray such a prayer, that his Father would forgive those who had caused him so much pain. That's actually pretty easy to believe. After all, that was his purpose in coming, that those who don't deserve it would still receive the forgiveness of all their sins. And when you consider what he endured to make that forgiveness possible, it is completely believable that he would say those words, even while hanging innocently on the cross. No, what's hard to believe is that the people who put Jesus on trial and scourged him and called for his crucifixion and then watched it happen, that they didn't know what they were doing. How could they not know? As we've seen the past few weeks, pretty much everything that Jesus said and did during his last days on earth was to prove that he was just who he said he was, the Messiah God promised to send. He was everything the prophets said he would be. And as we look through the gospel stories, lots of people, even the demons themselves, proclaimed that he was the Son of God. The Samaritan woman at the well recognized him as the son of David. The blind man could see it too. Even the centurion at the foot of the cross looked up and declared, "Surely this was the Son of God." Whether or not they fully understood who he was, it seems obvious that they knew he didn't deserve to be crucified. Yet there he was, beaten and bloody, life slowly draining from his body. How could they not know that they had put an innocent man to death? Perhaps I'm being a bit harsh, but I think they knew. They just didn't care. Now, I can't say that for certain because I wasn't there, but I can say this, that we, according to our sins, caused his death just as much as anyone who was there that day. We know it too. But that doesn't stop us from continuing to sin, does it? We just keep on sinning, making a mockery of his sacrifice, and using it to justify our own sinful thoughts, words, and deeds, as we tell ourselves, "It's okay. God will forgive me for this." Either that or we just don't care. We know it's wrong, but we do it anyway. Maybe Jesus was right after all. Maybe we really don't know what we're doing. How can we look at this supreme act of love and just keep on sinning? Father, forgive us. We now sing the first two verses of hymn 453, "Upon the Cross Extended." Our second reading for tonight also comes from Luke's Gospel, chapter 23. One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Have you ever wondered what the first thief did after he said that? Was his heart changed? Did he come to faith? Or did he do what so many people do today? Ignore Jesus because he had no use for a crucified God. We know what he wanted. When he said, "Are you not the Christ?" what he really wanted to say was, "If you are, save yourself. And while you're at it, us too." And so I imagine that when he heard, "Today you will be with me in paradise," spoken to the second thief, that's not exactly what he wanted to hear. He wanted to hear, "It'll be okay. I'm fixing to get off this cross any moment now and punish everyone who did this to me. And while I'm at it, I'll get you down too." But that just wasn't part of the plan. Jesus came to give his life, and to give it abundantly. The kind of life that is so much more than stuff, an easy, comfortable life, and earthly things. That's what many people, including the first thief, want from God. And when Jesus doesn't deliver, it's amazing how fast they turn away from him, because then they have no use for him. In that way, the thief reminds me of Job's wife. You may remember, if you've read the book of Job, that in the midst of his terrible suffering, Job's wife saw that God wasn't doing anything to alleviate his suffering. So she said, "Are you still holding on to your integrity? Curse God and die. Curse God and die." Sadly, that's just what many people in our world have chosen to do. As Milton wrote in the book Paradise Lost, "Better to reign in hell than be a servant in heaven." Of course, we would never say that, right? We're faithful to God, and we trust him, no matter what tragedies may befall us. Yet how many of us have strived for these temporary, inferior things of the world because we think that in them we will have real security and true peace? Are we really any different than the first thief? The second thief, however, by faith, was moved to pray for something greater, stronger, and eternal. He prayed, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." In other words, "I don't want anything else except, Lord, to be with you." If only we would desire that gift, which we have already received, more than all the other things that we pursue. We now sing the next two verses of "Upon the Cross Extended." Our third reading for tonight comes from John's Gospel, chapter 19. When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things. But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. It really is amazing if you think about it. The soldiers had no qualms about tearing Jesus' body apart, but his tunic, which was a finely woven piece of cloth, that they cared about. "Let us not tear it," they said. What does that say about these men? That they cared nothing for the man, but they valued his tunic so much that they would rather see it go to someone else whole than to see it be destroyed. It says that these men were sinful, misguided human beings, just like the rest of us. How many times each and every week do we treat stuff as though it were more important than the people all around us? When a new techno gadget comes out, people will stand in line overnight to get it. When Walmart has a Black Friday sale on TVs, people will literally hurt and hurdle others just to make sure they get theirs. As Americans, it's amazing to see how hard we are willing to work and save and sacrifice just so we can have things that are bigger, better, and faster. We certainly are rich in things, but we're awfully poor in spirit. Do you remember the story of Jonah? Many of you do. But how many people forget how the story ends? The end of the story is that Jonah climbs up on a hill to wait and watch joyfully for the wrath of God to rain down on Nineveh. While he waited, God provided for him a plant that sprung up quickly and gave Jonah shade from the hot sun. The next day, God caused the plant to wither and die. Jonah was so upset about the death of his plant that he told God he wanted to die. The irony of that story is that Jonah was devastated by the death of a plant while he waited for and cheered the destruction of nearly 120,000 citizens of Nineveh. Do you think his priorities were a little mixed up? No more than ours. Thousands of unborn children are murdered every day. Hundreds of thousands of children are being raised in broken, abusive homes. Millions of people are struggling with depression, poverty, or loneliness. Hundreds of millions are currently destined for eternal death in hell because they don't know Jesus Christ. And yet none of those things breaks our heart as much as cable going out or slow internet service. Jesus, however, did not love stuff. He loved people. That was obvious and true, even on the cross. It wasn't his own suffering that he was worried about as much as that of his blessed mother and his beloved disciple. It was their pain that he wanted to ease, because he loved them and us even more than his own life. We now sing the last three verses of hymn 453.
Thank you.
The fourth reading comes from Mark's Gospel, chapter 15. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders hearing it said, "Behold, he is calling Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and take him down." When Jesus cried out, "Eloi, Eloi, sabachthani," he was speaking the opening words to Psalm 22, a lengthy psalm of lament, sung by someone who was suffering, not only because of their enemies, but even more so because God had withdrawn his protection and aid. Basically, this long psalm could be summed up in one word: why? We know why. Every year at this time, perhaps even every Sunday, we're told why. Jesus died so that we could live. Why all the suffering, the anguish, the torture, and the death? In a nutshell, you and me. We are the reason that Jesus went through hell on this day nearly 2,000 years ago. Now, don't get me wrong, Jesus didn't literally go to the place of hell, at least not yet. He would eventually go there after his death, but not to suffer like so many seem to think. He went there to declare his victory over Satan and all his demons. So no, the hell that Jesus experienced happened while he was still alive. It was that moment when his Father withdrew from him, abandoning him to suffer all alone and die on Calvary's cross. Why would the Father do such a thing? Because that's what hell is: separation from God. Now, I don't know whether the lake of fire or perpetual darkness or gnashing of teeth was literal or just figurative. But what I do know is this: hell means God's not there. That's what makes it hell. And Jesus experienced that hell right here on earth, on the cross, so that we wouldn't have to. Separating us from God is what sin does. It's what Satan does. And it's what death tries to do. But because Christ willingly suffered the penalty for all of our transgressions, and he did it in our place, he has removed everything they had the power to do to separate us from the Father. And yet, despite all that he's done to unite us to the Father, still we willingly choose to separate ourselves from God. Not just on those Sundays when we make plans to be somewhere else rather than God's house, but each and every day as we shun his word and refuse to pray. Instead of fearing hell, we invite it into our lives every day. We now sing the first two verses of hymn 439, "O dearest Jesus, what law have you broken?" Our fifth reading comes from John's Gospel, chapter 19. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus spoke the opening words of Psalm 22, which we talked about just a few moments ago, he was applying all of the words of that psalm to himself. That's certainly true for verses 14 and 15, which said, "I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within my breast. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death." As one doctor who has studied crucifixions pointed out, quote, "Having suffered from the beatings and flogging, Jesus suffered from severe hypovolemia, the result of a tremendous loss of blood." Therefore, these verses from Psalm 22 describe accurately Jesus' dehydrated state and loss of his strength. And when the cross was finally put upright with Jesus on it, it put a tremendous strain on his arms and shoulders, likely causing the dislocation of his shoulder and elbow joints. As time passed, the muscles, from the loss of blood and other fluids, as well as the fixed position of the body, would suffer severe cramps. Close quote. There's no doubt that when Jesus said, "I thirst," he said it to fulfill the words of Psalm 69, verse 21, which said, "They gave me poison for food, and for my thirst they gave me sour wine to drink." John specifically said that in the text. But as you can see from the doctor's description of what our Lord's body endured during his crucifixion, it's also likely that he really was thirsty. That's about the only aspect of our Lord's crucifixion that any of us can relate to. We all know what it's like to be thirsty. Some of us have been dehydrated to the point of suffering severe cramps, where every muscle is contracted tightly, causing great pain, perhaps even disability. If you've ever experienced that, then maybe you can begin to understand the intense pain Jesus was experiencing on the cross. All of us know what it is to suffer pain, and most of us know how far we would go and how much we would pay to have that pain taken away. But few of us will ever know what it would be like to choose pain for ourselves so that someone else wouldn't have to experience it. Fewer still would make that choice on behalf of strangers, and even less than that, for those who hate us. But none of us will ever know what it was like to suffer as Christ did. And the reason we'll never know that kind of suffering is because he's already suffered it for us. As Paul wrote in chapter 5 of his letter to the Romans, "Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." We now sing the next two verses of hymn 439. The sixth reading comes from John's Gospel, chapter 19. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. In chapter 12 of Luke's Gospel, verse 50, Jesus said, "I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished." As you can see from the very beginning of his earthly ministry, Jesus knew that this is how his life's story was going to end. In fact, he knew it even before he came to the earth to become incarnate as a fully human being. He knew the Old Testament prophecies, especially these words from the prophet Isaiah, recorded in chapters 52 and 53. "We considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. Yahweh has laid on him the iniquity of us all. It was Yahweh's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. Yahweh makes his life a guilt offering." And so nothing that Jesus endured that day, nothing that he experienced, was a surprise to him. He knew that this was the Father's plan from the moment when man first sinned. God said that one day one of Eve's descendants was going to crush the serpent's head, although it was also going to hurt the heel of the one who did it. A few years ago, the Martin Luther exhibit came to Minnesota, and as I walked around looking at the different exhibits, the person giving the tour talked about a painting of a foot stepping on the head of a serpent. They said they didn't know what it was, but I did. It was the medieval representation of Christ stepping on the head of the devil. But defeating the devil wasn't going to be painless or easy. The one who accomplished it was going to suffer more than anyone ever has or could. Jesus certainly had the power to defeat the devil with the snap of his fingers, but that still wouldn't change the fact that the devil had already succeeded in leading mankind into sin. And the penalty which God's law demanded for sin was nothing less than separation from him and eternal death. Simply defeating Satan couldn't change that. Only by fulfilling the law's demands himself could the devil's work be truly undone. Only by allowing his hands and his heels to be pierced by death itself could Jesus fully destroy the devil and all his wicked works. Only by taking on our sins unto himself and then putting those sins to death could Christ destroy its power over us. Only his righteousness, received by us, by faith, could make us righteous in God's eyes once more. And only his death could give us life with God once more. The entire Bible up to this point has been written to prepare God's people for this moment. This is the climax of God's love story with us. God's plan was finally being fulfilled. Everything that needed to be done, all the scriptures that pointed to Christ, and all the promises that God made, at that moment, they were all brought to their completion. It truly was finished. We now sing two more verses of hymn 439.
Thank you.
Our seventh and final reading comes from Luke's Gospel, chapter 23. It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, when the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. Throughout his life, Jesus was the perfect example of what God created us to be. Not only was he without sin, but his will conformed perfectly to the Father's will. And above all else, Jesus loved his Father and desired nothing more than to be near him, either physically by going regularly to the temple or spiritually by going to him constantly in prayer. Despite the fact that the Father had abandoned him, leaving him to spend his final moments alone on that cross, Jesus still sought to be near his Father, not to question him, not to rebuke him. No, he went to his Father so that Jesus' sacrifice might be complete. He wanted to give all of himself, the very last ounce of himself, to the Father. It was as if he was saying, "All I have left to give you is my life, and I gladly give it to you now." With his last breath, Jesus entrusted himself to his Father. There's nothing else in the scriptures that can compare to this act of love and devotion from the Son to his Father. No one ever trusted God or obeyed him or glorified him as Jesus did with his life and with his death. The next closest example I can think of goes back again to Job. And it was when Job declared about God, "Even though he slay me, yet I will still hope in him." The major difference, of course, is that for Jesus, it wasn't a hypothetical. It wasn't a matter of if God should slay me, then I will trust in him. For Jesus, it was literally, "Even though he slays me, yet I will love, honor, and obey him." It's tempting to see Christ on the cross and think only of his love for us. And surely his death was the ultimate demonstration of his love for us. But let's not forget, this was an act of love for his Father as well. By fulfilling the work his Father had given him to do, Jesus not only obeyed his Father, he also glorified him. And now at the end of all things, of all the things he could have said or done, here in his last moments, Jesus chose to turn to his Father in prayer one last time to offer up to him the full and final measure of his devotion. In life and in death, Jesus and his Father were one. And by his atoning sacrifice, Christ has made us one with the Father as well. That's why even in our darkest hours, we can entrust our lives and yes, even our deaths to the Lord, because we know that for Jesus' sake, he is with us always to the very end of the age. Amen. We now sing one more verse of hymn 439. We now stand for the prayer of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated. We now sing the first three verses of hymn 456, Were You There? During this time, the sanctuary is now almost completely dark, all except for the light of the Paschal candle. The Paschal candle represents the light of Christ. The darkness represents his suffering and death. In just a moment, the Paschal candle will be removed, symbolizing the burial of Jesus. Now the light has gone away. The sanctuary is now dark. In just a moment, two sounds will be heard. The first, a loud noise reminding us of the earthquake that occurred at the time of Jesus' death. The other sound reminds us how the temple curtain was torn in half, showing how sin's power to separate us from God has been destroyed. now that the Paschal candle has returned to the chancel, we are reminded that Jesus has promised to return to life once more. In just a moment, we will leave the service silently, but with hope. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not overcome it. As we now leave the church in darkness and silence, so shall we return on Sunday morning in the same way, in remembrance of the women who went solemnly to Jesus' tomb to finish the burial process which they started this evening, nearly 2,000 years ago.